So good morning, everyone. So I'm talking from the center of Italy, and I hope you are safe and well with these hot times we are living. So the topic of this talk is about the corpus callosum anomalies, especially focusing on two main issues, which are complete and partial agenesis of the corpus callosum. And during this brief talk, I will go through a series of clinical questions on diagnosis, prognosis, and counseling of this anomaly. So the first one, so why the corpus callosum is so important? What is the corpus callosum? So this is the main commissural pathway of the fetal brain, which means that there is a series of fibers which connects different parts of the brain with a fundamental and crucial role in connecting the different parts of the brain. And it mediates different roles in motor, cognitive, and neurological function. So this is why is so important that we detect corpus callosum before birth. How can we see the corpus callosum on ultrasound? Which planes we should achieve in order to have a proper visualization of the structures? So usually, it is not possible to have a direct look at the corpus callosum by using the standard axial plane of the fetal brain, which is required by the International Society of Gynecology and Obstetrics, the ISUG. Essentially, the only way to see the corpus callosum is to obtain a mid-sagittal view of the fetal brain. So we should do multiplanar sonography, either by transabdominal or transvaginal approach. And in this way, the corpus callosum is seen as a thin anechoic structure in the anterior middle part of the brain, which is surrounded by two echogenic lines. And the structure has a coma-like shape. We used to identify four different parts of it, which is the rostrum, the genome, the body, and the splenium, which is the most posterior part. And usually, this structure develops with a craniocaudal development. So this is what we see at grayscale ultrasound. If we want to help ourselves, we can put the color Doppler, and we can see at this point the branching or the anterior cerebral artery, which is called pericallosal artery, which surrounded the structure itself. So we can use either two different approaches, which is grayscale and color Doppler ultrasound. However, during the routine anomaly scan, we usually do not achieve this view. So the only things we have to see that the corpus callosum is present is to look at the anterior part of the brain, what is called the anterior complex, in which we say essentially three main structures, the cavum septi pellucidi and the two frontal horns. Now the cavum septi pellucidi is the anechoic square box structure in the anterior part of the brain. It is usually covered superiorly by the corpus callosum, which forms the roof of the cavum septi pellucidi. So by convention, we assume that if the cavum septi pellucidi is there, conventionally, at least the corpus callosum should be present, although this is not always true, and we can discuss it later. However, when we look at the cavum septi pellucidi, we have to be very careful or not to misdiagnose this structure with this one. So as you can see, this is the cavum septi pellucidi, which is a completely anechoic and square box structure. But if you go slightly down with the probe, you can see this structure which resembles the cavum septi pellucidi. But the only difference is that there is an echogenic line in between. Now, this is a completely different structure, which are the pair columns of the fornices. Now, the cavum septi pellucidi is related to the formation of the corpus callosum, while the fornices are not. And this is one of the main reasons, because the agenesis of the corpus callosum is missed during prenatal assessment. Okay, then if you are more experienced, we can have a look at the corpus callosum by obtaining a coronal view of the fetal brain, in which you can see the first structure is the interhemispheric fissure, Then there is the sulcus of the corpus callosum, is the anechoic structure here, just slightly above the cavum septi is the corpus callosum itself. So essentially we can have a look at this structure directly by having, by obtaining a sagittal and coronal view of the brain, and indirectly by looking at the cavum septi pellucidi. Okay, now that we've seen how, so which kind of session, which kind of planes we should obtain in order to have the diagnosis of corpus callosum. So how can we diagnose ACC prenatally? So as I told you earlier, we usually, during the second trimester screening assessment, the anomaly scan, we do not look directly at the corpus callosum. So we usually suspect that the corpus callosum is absent by looking at indirect signs. The first one is the absence of the cavum septi pellucidi. So can you see there that there is no this anechoic square box? So the absence of the corpus callosum determines a complete rearrangement of the fetal brain. And this is visible, especially in the posterior part of the brain, in which the absence of the posterior part of the corpus callosum determines a posterior expansion of the ventricles, which assumes a teardrop space called colpocephaly. So, absent cavum septi, ventriculomegaly, and especially this funny shape posterior ventricle, and the third signs is the widening of the interhemispheric fissure and upward displacement of the third ventricle. So this is a comparison between the normal fetus. You can see the corpus callosum here, you can see the cavum septi pellucidi here, then you can see the frontal horns, which are actually really close connection with the cavum septi pellucidi there. And then in these figures, there is no cavum septi pellucidi at all. Another sign is that when the corpus callosum is absent, usually we have bundles of aberrant fibers. We run parallel to the midline and which cross the midline usually in this position. So this aberrant curve of the fibers determines a lateral displacement of the frontal horns, which are actually pushed laterally. Okay, another indirect sign of this anomaly is the presence of the radial disposition of the cerebral fissure, which actually is most visible on MRI. Okay, now the only planes which help us in saying that the corpus callosum is not present is the mid-sagittal plane of the fetal brain, in which there is no visualization of the corpus callosum at all, and in which there is an abnormal curve of the middle cerebral artery. We actually ascend directly to the calvarius. So we have not the artery which surrounded all the shape of the structure. And this is a comparison between a normal case, which can you see this funny curve of the middle cerebral artery. In this case, in which the corpus callosum is not present, we have not, we have the anterior cerebral artery which ascends directly to the calvarium. If we want to confirm the diagnosis, we can obtain a coronal view of the fetal brain, in which we say that the cavum septi pellucidi is not present, that the anechoic structure representing the corpus callosum is not present, and we see that the frontal horns are displaced laterally from the interhemispheric fissure. And this is also, a comparison between a normal coronal assessment, normal coronal view of the brain, in which you see interhemispheric fissure, the corpus callosum, the cavum septi pellucidi here, and we have the frontal horns laterally in this session, in these figures, which is from a fetus with ACC, in which there is no cavum septi, there is no corpus callosum, and in which the frontal horns are displaced. We have to be very careful when we scan a patient, because we know that some condition, and this is especially true for arachnoid cysts and lipomas of the corpus callosum, which can underline the absence of these structures. So all I told us until now represent the main diagnostic criteria for the complete agenesis of the corpus callosum. But we know that the less frequent type of corpus callosum anomaly is when the corpus callosum is partially present, which is called partial agenesis of the corpus callosum. In this condition, we usually have a corpus, a carbon septi pellucidi, which is visible, although some authors say that is kindly of be slightly shorter than normal. We have, in this case, we can see a partial visualization of the corpus callosum. And usually, if the corpus callosum is partially absent, this is the posterior part which is lacking, because the corpus callosum develops through a craniocaudal sequence. The issue now is that why the corpus callosum is missed so frequently? Because we know, this is a really, I think it's a really seminal paper from Professor Paladini, that the ultrasound signs of corpus callosum change through gestation. Because most of them, especially colpocephaly, non-visualization of the corpus of the carbon septi pellucidi, are actually less frequent in the second trimester than in the third trimester. So some of these signs are not so easy to detect during the time of the routine anomaly scan, while they can become more obvious with ongoing gestation. Okay, and these are actually a resume of the difference between complete and partial agenesis. In complete agenesis, we have absent carbon septi, which in partial agenesis, we might have a visible carbon septi pellucidi. And this is especially in this condition, the signs are more subtle than in complete agenesis. So once we have diagnosed the condition, should we offer karyotype to these women? Yes, essentially yes, because we know that at least in 5% of cases in complete agenesis, in 8% of cases in partial agenesis, we might have chromosomal anomalies even in fetuses with isolated anomaly, with isolated ACC, which is defined as ACC with no obvious anomalies at the scan. And in almost 6% of cases, we can have an abnormal result at chromosomal microarray analysis. So we need to perform an invasive. Next question, should we arrange for follow-up scans? Yes, of course, because we know that the main determinant of the outcome of fetuses and children with ACC, with a genesis of the corpus callosum, either complete or partial, might have associated anomaly, which are detected at follow-up in almost 10% of cases. So what we usually label as isolated corpus callosum agenesis in the second trimester might not be completely true with ongoing gestation. So we should arrange for follow-up scan. And what about MRI? So should we perform an MRI? Now we can discuss it later because there is a lot of discussion about whether MRI is better than ultrasound or vice versa in fetal brain anomalies. What we know is that if we apply MRI to fetuses with corpus callosum agenesis, we might have additional anomalies detected exclusively at prenatal MRI in almost is about 8% of cases with ACC and 12% of cases in partial agenesis of the corpus callosum. But the most important issue, so I think that the main purpose of prenatal diagnosis is not just to detect condition. So this is the most easy things to do. So the fetal medicine specialists, the specialists in prenatal medicine should use imaging to determine the prognosis. So now what should we tell parents? So what is the actual burden of a neurodevelopmental outcome in fetuses with isolated agenesis of the corpus callosum? So what we know, we ran this paper about a few years ago, and we included only cases with either complete or partial isolated ACC. And we saw that in fetuses with isolated ACC confirmed at birth, the rate of abnormal borderline to moderate adverse outcome is about 60% in fetuses with complete ACC, while the rate of severe neurodevelopmental outcome is about 8%. Conversely, almost two-thirds of fetuses develops normally, although this is normal, the word normal has to be questioned because, of course, the follow-up was extremely variable. Conversely, in fetuses with partial agenesis of the corpus callosum, the rate of abnormal outcome, borderline to moderate abnormal outcome, is about 15%, while the rate of severe neurodevelopmental outcome was about 30%. However, as I told earlier, the main limitation of the studies was the really huge heterogeneity in rare follow-up, imaging assessment and neurodevelopmental tools adopted. So in conclusion, in order to detect corpus callosum agenesis, we should use a multiplanar sonography, which unfortunately is not in the general guidelines for the standard screening on the fetal brain. Longitudinal follow-up, and especially fetal MRI, is essential in order to confirm that the anomaly is isolated. But at the end of the day, the most important things to define is the outcome, because there was extremely variability in the published papers. And of course, some of the neurodevelopmental anomalies can become evident only after birth. So by conclusion, I want to invite you. So we have just set up this international collaboration a few months ago, in which we are running several studies on fetal brain. And the next one will be about the role of MRI in fetuses with isolated ACC confirmed and multiplanar sonography. If you want to join, which is be a huge pleasure, please contact me or Heider Filo, which is the PI of the study. Thank you very much indeed.